Turkish workers meet for prayer in their local mosque. But their mosque is far from home. For the Turks who gather here are migrant laborers, whose economic mecca is Western Europe. Guest workers who have come to Holland, to the city of Rotterdam. Of all the changes which industrial prosperity has brought to Western Europe, none has been more dramatic than the influx in ever-growing numbers of the so-called guest workers, the migrant laborers who come on short-term contract, mostly from beyond the borders of the common market countries. In Holland today, there are 150,000 of these guest workers, and the largest single group are the Turks. Coming as they often do from a peasant background, they could never hope in their home country to match the money they can earn here. But Holland, for her part, is not dispensing charity. She has her own urgent reasons for inviting them.
Two reasons, I would say. Economic growth, which still is a bit of a sacred cow here, although becoming less and less so. And secondly, because there are a lot of jobs that only need unskilled labor, very often the dirty jobs in industry, that the Dutch simply don't want to do anymore. And since we had a tense labor market, it was impossible to find people. They would clean toilets and sweep floors and be a waiter and that sort of thing. And that's the reason why we started importing them. A Dutch worker in industry who gets unemployed will still not be willing to do the dirty work. He will go on, how do you call it, in welfare. I mean, he'd go and get his unemployment pay, and that's that. You still need the guest workers to do the work that the Dutch don't want to do anymore.
The street names in the area where the violence erupted, the Afrikanerboot, date from the Boer War, reminders of another continent and a more extreme racism. The Afrikanerboot represents the dark side of the common market miracle. By the standards of other European countries, including Britain, it is neither a slum nor a ghetto. But it is a decaying and overcrowded area where Dutch workers and Turkish migrants live cheek by jowl, and where they must grudgingly remain while Holland's chronic housing shortage continues. In these conditions, the harsh behavior of one Turkish landlord was enough to ignite the whole area. Willem Brugsma, editor of the news magazine HP, predicted last year that there would be trouble in Rotterdam. It still came as a shock to most of his countrymen.
Well, the thing is, I suppose that a lot of Dutchmen were surprised that it happened in Holland, because the Dutch have, at least in this respect, always considered themselves to be holier than thou, holier than the rest of the world. And that's probably because over the century, this country has given asylum to a lot of persecuted people. For a long time to Jews, both from Eastern and Southern Europe, then to French Protestants, all of which is not surprising, because these people were persecuted by the Catholics, and so were we. And then after the war, we had these people from Indonesia who had Dutch passports, but very often, to all intents and purposes, were almost Indonesian, and they assimilated without great difficulties, really. That's probably their merit and not ours so much. But anyhow, we had this feeling that we were better than the South Africans, and we were better than the Americans, and we were more tolerant than the English. And now all of a sudden this happened. And it surprised a lot of people.
Before the first Turkish guest workers came to Holland in the mid-60s, Spain was the main supplier of foreign labor. At the huge Hoogeveen steelworks, the third largest in Western Europe, Spaniards still outnumber all other migrant groups. Out of 23,000 workers, 10% are Spanish. When the company recruits them, as is the case with all guest workers, they must guarantee accommodation throughout their one-year contract. To meet this obligation, Hoogeveen's bought in 1961 the Arosa Sun, an old French passenger ship, and moored it alongside the works. The Arosa Sun houses 500 workers at a very reasonable rent, on average £4 a week for full board. Spanish chefs prepare the food, and the company also provides resident translators, doctors, and nurses. But the ship was bought as a short-term measure. In the next few years, it will hopefully be replaced by new hostels near the works. This new hostel, like the ship, is for men only. 450 men without their wives. The company had to work hard to persuade local residents to accept them. Although Hoogeveen's employ a small number of other foreigners, they've specialized, probably wisely, in Spaniards.
Does it make any difference whether the foreign workers who are living in a particular community are Spanish, Italians, Turkish?
Yeah, it seems to make a difference. I mean, the Spaniards have a very good reputation. The Italians have got a very reasonable reputation. But the more you get to the south, the more difficult it gets, and the problems will certainly be with the Moroccans, the Algerians, and the Turks, because they are simply more different than the Spaniards and the Italians. The fact that the Turks and the Moroccans and the Algerians are Muslims might cause extra resentment, because they have a reputation that Muslims have God knows four wives and 40 concubines, and that they are sexually dangerous, much more than Spaniards or Italians. And that they're totally ununderstandable. I mean, most Dutch workers, no, not most Dutch workers, but a lot of Dutch workers go to Spain on their holidays. They go to the Costa del Sol, the Costa Brava, and they like Spain, and they think, and they like flamenco, and you can see that's becoming familiar, that's European. But the other side of the Mediterranean, that's a different cup of tea.
Could the Rotterdam riots happen again?
Yes. Yes, because the situation remains the same. I mean, you get concentrations of guest workers in parts of industrial towns, and there'll always be this sort of chronic misunderstanding, fear, all the old bogeys of your women are no longer safe to walk the streets, you say, and that sort of builds up, and then you get a small incident, like with the landlord, and it blows up again. It's quite possible.
In the Afrikanerboot district of Rotterdam, where the August rioting broke out, most Turkish workers, like guest workers generally, are either single or unaccompanied married men. For the first year of their contract, they're not allowed to bring their wives, and can only bring them after that if they can find a suitable place to live. Given the general housing shortage, few of them succeed. If there is no company hostel, they live in boarding houses like this, four and sometimes six to a room. An employer who recruits guest workers is required not only to guarantee accommodation, but to inspect it regularly. But there are good and bad employers. The Turks who live here pay £12 a week in rent, four times what a Dutchman would pay. The owner of a boarding house was recently taken before a rent tribunal and forced to reduce his rents by two-thirds. But the exploitation goes on, because the plain fact is that Turks who live in these conditions have nowhere else to go. This deserted building sums up the resentment the authorities must face in attempting to house foreign workers in other less crowded areas. Formerly a home for unmarried mothers, it stands in the Rotterdam suburb of Overschie. Last November, the council announced plans to convert it into a hostel for 200 guest workers. Since then, the windows and many of the fittings have been systematically smashed and part of the building set on fire. The street where it happened is a haven of middle-class respectability. There are 20 houses here, the homes of doctors, lawyers, businessmen. When they heard of the council's plan to bring in guest workers, they formed an action committee to stop it. They made no attempt to stop the vandalism. But there were other people from the surrounding area who did try.
Mrs. Janssen, what has been happening here?
Well, I heard now about a week ago from boys in the neighborhood that they were destroying that building here. So the next day I went there and I saw about 10 children throwing stones inside. There were also some girls, and I asked them, I said, hey, what are you doing there? They said that is against the guest laborers, the strangers from outside who work here, as we do not want them here in the neighborhood. And then suddenly all of them ran away, and I went to the police office and I said to the police, do you know that that a big building there is destroyed? And they said, yes, yes, we know something about it, but we can't do anything about it because we cannot watch there every moment. And then they asked me, who are you? I said, I am Mrs. Janssen, and I am a member of that action committee pro gastarbeiders, pro guest laborers, pro strangers. And then they said, why don't you go there with your group and protect the house? I said, that is not my job, it is your job.
But what about these young people that you saw? What did they say to you about what they were doing?
Well, they said to me, we want to destroy it here as we do not want strangers in the neighborhood.
Well, were these just young hooligans and maybe their parents didn't know what they were doing?
I have a feeling that a lot of them are here from that so-called better situated streets here in the neighborhood, as exactly those people are protesting in such a strong way.
You think these are children of people who live in the neighborhood?
I think it's a lot of them. Perhaps not all of them, as what I saw, that were about 10, but far more children or other people must have been busy here. And everybody is silent, everybody, nobody wants to talk about it. That makes it so mysterious.
Would the local people have protested against any workers, even Dutch workers, coming here? Is it particularly against foreigners?
Particularly against strangers, absolutely. Yeah. It is a kind of racism.
It is not only national differences that set guest workers, like the Turks, apart. There is a class distinction, too. For the guest workers of Europe are a new and more lowly working class. They get the same rate for the job that a Dutch worker would get, but the jobs they do are the jobs nobody wants. For many of them, the factory where they work is the first they have ever seen in their lives. They work hard and they save hard. Their dream is to go home to Turkey with enough money to buy a shop, a taxi, or a tractor and some farmland. Of the four workers I spoke to at a cable factory, two had worked as farmers in Turkey and two were laborers.
What were the biggest difficulties and problems that they faced when they first came over here?
Buraya ilk geldiğinizde karşılaştığınız en büyük güçlük nedir? Language and adaptation to Holland, that is two of problems.
But what are the most difficult things about adapting to living in Holland, apart from language?
Buraya alışmak için, mesela lisandan başka buraya alışabilmek için en büyük güçlük nedir mesela?
Yemek, su, yemek içme.
Fooding is very, very important,
food.
We said. Food, yeah.
Anything else from that?
Başka?
Havası ne? Havası.
Bizim sıcak anne. Air, you know, and Turkey is a very hot country. And here it's cold. It's also difficult for them to adapt themselves.
Do you feel very homesick?
Memleketi çok özlüyor musunuz? Yeah, very much. Especially children.
How many children have you?
Kaç tane çocuğunuz var?
Benim 5 tane çocuğum.
5 children, yes.
And how often do you see them?
Ne kadar, ne zaman, kaç senede, ne zamandan ne zamana görebiliyorsun onları?
Senede bir.
Once in a year.
What would you hope they will do when they grow up?
What he hope?
His children.
His children. Ne olmak çocukların ne yapmak istiyorlar büyüdükleri zaman?
Çocukları okudu adam.
I want to give a better education to my children than I am, that they get a nice position in the community. You know?
Would you like them to be able to stay in Turkey and work in Turkey?
Türkiye'de kalıp onlar acaba Türkiye'de çalışabilecekler mi?
Çalışırlar o kısmen
ya. I think so. If they have a nice, good education, then they can find work there.
How are the Dutch government coping with the growing number of guest workers, and do they want to integrate them? At The Hague, the Minister of Social Affairs outlined their policy.
The foreign workers who are coming here for work for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, we do not want to integrate them, and they do not want to be integrated. On the contrary, we make substantial efforts to help them in preserving their national identity. And we respect their identity. And after some years, they are going back home again. Holland is not an immigration country. And when they are recruited, we tell them also, you can work here, you get a contract for 1 year. You can renew the contract after 1 year, maybe. That depends upon the labor market situation. But then you have to go back.
Separated from their Dutch neighbors by language, culture, and religion, and separated from their own wives and families, the Turkish workers understandably prefer their own company and their own entertainment. Although the government may not want to integrate their Turkish workers, the Rotterdam riots made it only too clear that a separate people can all too easily arouse resentment and open hostility. Apart from the Turks, Holland is faced with the increasing problem of its own coloured immigrants from the Dutch West Indies. And when Britain joins the common market, many of our Asian and West Indian workers could swell the amount of migrant labour in an already overcrowded country.
What is your government's attitude to the possible arrival as guest workers of British coloured immigrants?
Well, in the first place, I would say that there are no coloured workers in my books, only workers. We have also not an Enoch Powell in Holland. So we must nevertheless be careful that we don't get such people here, like Enoch Powell, and that we don't get a racial situation, which is everywhere, all over the world is possible, also in Holland. Well, I must say, in second place, we are treaty-bound to allow the entry of British workers. It's irrelevant if they are colored or not. There is, of course, possible a situation which can arise and which gives difficulties. In such case, there is has been agreed upon in the common market negotiations, also with Great Britain, that a consultation will start in Brussels to avoid disturbance of the labor market in Holland. But we can't do it on ourselves. We have to agree with, for instance, the Brussels authorities and the British authorities to look at any problem which can exist in such a situation when, for instance, thousands and thousands of Pakistani or Indians enter Holland to look for work. In such a situation, we have to renew the negotiations in Brussels. But that's, I do expect, not a normal situation. I do not expect at this moment that thousands and thousands of unemployed workers from Pakistan or India or Jamaica who are living now in Great Britain to come to Holland. I do not expect that at this moment. But they are free when Great Britain has entered the common market. They are free to look for work in Holland, and we have agreed upon that. That's we are treaty bound, as I said.
There seems to be little doubt that if Holland were to be faced with a new wave of coloured migrants from Britain, she would seek some agreement with her common market partners to limit their numbers. Because proud though the country is of her reputation for tolerance, the numbers of foreign workers she has been importing, however necessary, however vital to her economy, have already strained that tolerance. The riots in Rotterdam are not seen here as an isolated incident, but as a long-term warning.
3 or 4 years ago, people, when we were still in the trance of economic growth, especially in Rotterdam, which is the overheated center of economic growth, and people sort of glibly said, well, by the year 1980, Rotterdam, greater Rotterdam, will need 350,000 guest workers. But nobody's sitting down and think about the social consequences. I mean, how would they be housed? Would they be allowed to take their families? One would have to build a town for them. Or would one just get the men and put them in a large ghetto? Would they need Dutch prostitutes? Or would one have to import Turkish prostitutes as well? Nobody thought about that at that time. Now, of course, and again, this thing might help. People will think about it, and maybe we'll think about it in the wider context of how much economic growth do you really need.
Holland has had more than 10 years' experience of the guest workers' situation. To judge from the events in Rotterdam, it has brought to the surface feelings which Dutch people are not supposed to have. How do you regard this experience? Would you say that it has done damage to the Dutch character?
Well, no, I would think it's been a very useful experience. I think it's much better for the Dutch character that the Dutch stop thinking that they're holier than others. And if they start thinking about it in the right context, at least what I think is the right context, that this is a sort of consequence of too much economic growth. And that they come because we don't want to do the dirty work. And that if it goes on, we would get a sort of society that one should not really want to have with managers on top and then sort of superior workers who will be Dutch in the middle and sort of slaves, neo-slaves, whom you import by the shipload somewhere underneath, which I think is a highly undesirable society.
In Europe today, there are 3.5 million guest workers, 150,000 of them in Holland. While the common market continues to thrive, their numbers are increasing year by year. They come to Western Europe because they need the money. Europe hires them because she needs their labor. So far, those motives have made simple economic sense. After the Rotterdam riots, that may not be enough.